I'm not one of the people who thinks that the Keith Richards solo albums are absolutely great. But they are better than Mick Jagger's solo albums. And that's because Mick Jagger has these pop ambitions and Keith Richards does not.
Talk Is Cheap is the sound of a man who, you know, really wanted to work with a bunch of guys who were really going to get into the music, you know, and it was a fantastic band. Jordan, Waddy Wachtel, Charlie Drayton, and so on. He really wanted to have some fun. He really wanted to, you know, record some music that came from his gut.
They epitomize.
The Stones would be brought together again in 1989 when they were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame by Pete Townsend.
Whatever you do, don't
Mick and Keith, both with solo projects now behind them, decided to bury the hatchet and refocus on their band.
You know, it's slightly ironic that tonight we're all on it. You see us on our best behaviour, but we're being rewarded for 25 years of bad behaviour. I must say, I'm very proud to work with this group of musicians for 25 years. The other thing I'm very proud of is the songs that Keith and I have written over the last 25 years. I'd like to pay tribute to two people who can't be here tonight. One, Ian Stewart, a great friend, a great blues pianist, whose odd but invaluable musical advice kept us on a steady bluesy course for most of the time. And to Brian Jones, whose individuality and musicianship often took us off the bluesy course, with some often marvellous results.
Yo.
Jean Cocteau said that Americans are funny people. First you shock them, then they put you in a museum. So on behalf of the Stones, I'd like to thank you very much for this award.
The Stones' next album, Steel Wheels, met with a better response than their previous two efforts. And this time the band concentrated on bringing their live act back with a bang. From now on, the Stones would be directing most of their energy on their gargantuan and often star-studded stage shows.
Let's drink to the hard-working people. Let's drink to the lonely of mirth.
Raise your glass to the good and the evil. Let's drink to the soul of the earth.
I think when the Stones reunited, you know, for Steel Wheels, you know, I think Jagger had gotten over whatever his fantasies about his solo career or, you know, his sense that he was better than rock and roll or the Rolling Stones. Keith had worked through the worst of his drug problems and had had his own solo band and was, you know, ready to get back to work. And, you know, the Stones got back and, you know, as a live band, you know, I think have just been working at a very, very high rate since that time.
It was almost as if, like the Grateful Dead, they threw in the towel as regards making studio albums. You know, the Grateful Dead went years without making a studio record, and they just became a touring band. And in a way, that's what the Stones did. And they still touted themselves as the greatest rock and roll band in the world on the strength of touring and playing the old songs. You know, there are very few songs from the later albums that have taken their place in the core repertoire of the songs that they toured. So this is how they reinvented themselves. They're the greatest touring rock and roll band in the world.
Over the last 20 years, the Stones' concerts and tours have become progressively more ambitious and more elaborate. But as well as being defensive about their less impressive recorded works, they have had to shrug off criticisms that they were too old to be playing at a young man's game.
See the show if you can go. And then afterwards, if you want to tell me, you know, that ain't, you know, that's not a great rock and roll show, whatever, we can maybe have that conversation. But if you think that, you know, because they're the age they are, that they can't play a great show, you're wrong. And I've seen this band now for over the course of 40 years, you know, on almost every tour that they've done, and the Stones are playing at a very high rate. You know, if that, you know, period of music means anything to you, you know, if seeing one of the great bands, you know, perform means something, like, you know, you should catch one of these shows.
Despite the resurgence of the band, at least as a live act, Keith has continued to work on projects outside of the Stones. As well as releasing a second solo album, Main Offender, in 1992, he also worked on a record that put the spotlight on a unique set of musicians unknown to the Western world. Richards had fallen in love with Jamaica back in the early 70s and bought a villa there in which he could hide away from the public eye. In 1997, Richards set up his own record company, Mindless Records, and his first release was an album he had recorded 2 years before in his backyard, of a Jamaican drumming collective led by ska legend Justin Hines, called the Wingless Angels.
He had a nice big house, Point of View. It used to belong to Tommy Steele. So he's got a great house in Jamaica. He's got all the guys are coming up from the beach to jam with him because they know there's this rich rock star. Once they've stopped trying to rip him off and realize he's actually quite a nice bloke, he's got them working for him, and that's how the Wingless Angels started. And produced this album of hymns. But it was never given a big push. It was never like the window of Tower Records, Keith Richards, the Wingless Angel, because if any Keith fans buying it would have been horrified, you know, because basically it sounded like Razz Michael and the Sons of Nagus, you know, who these really, really grassroots Rastafarian outfits. But it was his dream to do.
Keith Richards loves music, and I think that all of the aspects of music kind of intrigue him. And so the degree to which these kind of, with the Wingless Angels project, I mean, I think the degree to which these kind of Anglican hymns sort of got transformed in this, you know, in this island culture into this, you know, kind of sinuous, you know, rhythmic, but still very kind of spiritually ambitious music was fascinating. And I think, you know, he was really taken with that and thought, well, you know, I can get that out to people. You know, I have, you know, the ability to kind of organize this and let people hear this. So there was just a kind of, I think, genuine fascination. I mean, he loves Jamaica, you know, and he loves all aspects of what that music is. And but on the other hand, this sounds absurd, but there's a kind of very traditional English element to Keith. And I think the combination of those things and the sound of the Wingless Angels, I think, definitely gripped him. And that's why I think he was drawn to it.
Although his role in modern music may have diminished,